Hi, I'm Beth, and today we're going to talk about modular arithmetic. So when we're telling the time, we wouldn't say 16 o'clock, we would say 4 o'clock. And likewise, we wouldn't say 19 o'clock, we would say 7 o'clock. So in our world of clocks, 16 and 4 are basically the same thing as are 19 and 7. To describe this mathematically, we say that 16 is congruent to 4, and 19 is congruent to 7, and we write it like this. Let's have a think about how we know that 16 o'clock is the same as 4 o'clock, or that 16 is congruent to 4. Perhaps when you think about telling the time, you imagine the afternoon times layered on top of their respective morning times, like this. 16 is next to the 4, so 16 is congruent to 4. Or maybe you think about the remainder when 16 is divided by 12. To get to 16 o'clock, you have to go around the clock once to reach 12 o'clock, and then you have to add on an extra 4 hours to reach 16. This is the same as saying that the remainder when you divide 16 by 12 is 4. So 16 is congruent to 4. In our day-to-day life, we of course only need 24 hours, but let's imagine for a moment that we can have more hours in the day. What would 26 o'clock be? Well, perhaps you can see that if we continue our clock labelling around, we've got 24 next to the 12, so 25 would be next to the 1, and 26 would be next to the 2. So 26 is congruent to 2. Alternatively, the remainder when we divide 26 by 12 is 2, because 2 12s are 24, and then you add 2 to get to 26. So 26 is congruent to 2. One change we need to make in our mathematical time-telling world is we actually need to replace this number at the top, the 12, with a 0, like this. So in fact, we actually say that 12 is congruent to 0, and also 24 would be congruent to 0, and in fact, any multiple of 12 would be congruent to 0. Further, we want to be really clear that we're working with a clock face that has 12 hours on it. To do this, we say that we're working modulo 12, and that all of these facts are true mod 12. What happens if we change the number of hours on the usual clock face? Here I've got a 5-hour clock face, so this is working modulo 5, and remember, we put a 0 at the top, not a 5. What would 6 o'clock be on a 5-hour clock? Well, perhaps you can imagine if we kept adding numbers next to the clock as before, the 5 would be by the 0, and then 6 would be next to the 1. So in fact, 6 is congruent to 1, modulo 5. How about 9 o'clock? Well, 5 would be here, so 6 is here, 7, 8, 9. So 9 is the same as 4 o'clock, or 9 is congruent to 4, modulo 5. And again, you can note that the remainder when you divide 9 by 5 is 4. How about 101? Well, 100 is divisible by 5. So every time you go around this clock, you're adding 5. So we go once round for 5, once round again for 10. So the top of the clock is where you hit all the multiples of 5. So 100 would appear at the top. To get to 101, you just jump over 1. So 101 would be congruent to 1 modulo 5. Again, you can also see this by thinking about the remainder when you divide 101 by 5. So far, we've worked modulo 12 and modulo 5, but we could work with clocks with any number of hours on. We could work modulo 7, modulo 39, modulo 100 even. Let's put what we've learned so far into practice.
So this question wants us to evaluate 5 mod 3. So we can think about this as a 3-hour clock. So we've got 0, 1 and 2. 3 would be above the 0, 4 would be above the 1, and 5 would be above the 2. So 5 is congruent to 2 mod 3. You can also think about this as the remainder when you divide 5 by 3 is 2. Now we want to evaluate 15 modulo 7. So we've got to think, what would 15 o'clock be on a 7-hour clock? 15 is 1 more than 14, and 14 is divisible by 7. So if you imagine our 7-hour clock with our 0 at the top, to get to 7 we'd go round once and end up at the top. To get to 14, we'd go around another time and end up at the top. And then to get to 15, we just need to go 1 hour further. So 15 is congruent to 1 mod 7. Also, you can think the remainder when we divide 15 by 7 is 1. How about 253 mod 5? Well, 250 is divisible by 5, so 250 would be at the top of the clock. Go round 3 more to get to 253, that would bring us to 3 o'clock. So 253 is congruent to 3 mod 5.
A third way to think about calculations modulo n, where n is any positive integer, is to imagine the number line, both positive and negative, coiling around itself and forming a new layer every n numbers. As you can see from this modulo 3 example, this forms columns of congruences. For instance, every number above or below the 1 is congruent to 1 modulo 3.
So to recap, we have 3 different ways of thinking about modular arithmetic so far. Our first method is the clock method, so if we're trying to find 5 mod 3, we can think, where would 5 o'clock appear on a 3-hour clock? We also have our spiral method, so we can think, where would 5 appear if we coiled around the number line every 3 numbers? And 5 would appear in the column with 2, so 5 is congruent to 2 mod 3. Or we can think about remainders. What's the remainder when I divide 5 by 3? And the answer, again, is 2. So lots of fellow students I've spoken to tend to think about modular arithmetic in different ways. So it's really up to you which way you prefer to think about it. Each way of thinking about modular arithmetic might have different benefits at different times. For instance, this spiral method is helpful when thinking about negative numbers. There's actually a fourth way of thinking about modular arithmetic that can be useful to know, and that's the formal definition. This is useful when proving things about modular arithmetic, but is maybe less helpful when you're actually trying to do calculations. So I won't go over it now, but I'll provide a link in the description below to a handout I made that has it on. There's a super useful theorem in modular arithmetic, which says that if x is congruent to a modulo n, and y is congruent to b modulo n, then x plus y is congruent to a plus b mod n, and x times y is congruent to a times b mod n. This might seem confusing to look at, but it's not so bad. Let's see what this actually means in practice. So say we want to work out 401 plus 62 modulo 4. We could calculate what 401 plus 62 is first, so that's 463, and then work out what this bigger number is, modulo 4. But now we have this theorem, and this theorem makes it a little bit easier. Instead of adding together these two numbers and then working out what that is, modulo 4, this theorem tells us we can work out what each of these smaller numbers is, modulo 4, and then add those things together. So 401 modulo 4, well, 400 is divisible by 4, so would be at the top of a 4-hour clock. To get to 401, we just need to go 1 around. So 401 is congruent to 1 modulo 4. 62 mod 4, well, 60 is divisible by 4, so 62 would leave remainder 2 when divided by 4. So 62 is congruent to 2 modulo 4. 1 plus 2 is 3, so this tells us that 401 plus 62 is congruent to 3 modulo 4. We can write this out properly like this. Using this theorem can save a lot of time when working out big calculations. Let's try use the second part of the theorem about multiplication on this question. So to evaluate 132 times 14 mod 7, again, we could simply calculate this product and then work out what this big product is, modulo 7. Or the easier way to save us doing really big multiplications is that we can use this theorem and work out what each of these smaller numbers is, modulo 7, and then multiply those together. So first we want 132 mod 7. Well, actually, I don't really care what that is. And I'll show you why, because 14 modulo 7 is 0, because 14 is divisible by 7. And anything times by 0 will give us 0. So it doesn't actually matter what this number is, modulo 7, because whatever it is, we're going to times it by 0, and that's going to give us 0. So 132 times 14 is congruent to 0 mod 7. And we can write it out formally like this. So you can see this theorem saved us a lot of work, as we didn't really need to calculate very much, as we knew that this was congruent to zero. We didn't have to do this big multiplying out calculation first. Let's try a final calculation using this theorem. So we want to calculate this modulo 8. And if we were to actually perform this calculation first before reducing it modulo 8, that would be quite a lot of work. Now, what this theorem tells us is that we don't need to perform this big calculation first. We can instead work out what each of these components are modulo 8. So 32 modulo 8, well, 32 is divisible by 8, so 32 is congruent to 0 mod 8. 17 mod 8, well, 16 is divisible by 8, so 16 would be at the top of the 8-hour clock, so 17 would be congruent to 1 modulo 8. 10 mod 8, well, 8 o'clock is at the top of the 8-hour clock, and so to get to 10 o'clock you go round 2, so 10 is congruent to 2 mod 8. So we can perform these calculations on these smaller numbers using this theorem. 0 plus, well, we do the brackets first, 1 times 2 is 2, so this is equal to 0 plus 2, which equals 2. So this mod 8 is just 2. So again, you can see how this theorem saves us a lot of time. Because this is a theorem, it has a proof. I won't go over the proof of it now, but if you're interested, click on the link in the description below for a handout that will have the proof of this on.
So why is modular arithmetic useful? Well, we can use this addition and multiplication theorem to answer many tricky questions about numbers. For instance, if we want to find the final digit of 7 to the power of 100, or work out if 4003 is the sum of two square numbers. These are questions that are made much simpler using modular arithmetic. Modular arithmetic is also a really powerful tool in cybersecurity. For instance, every time you enter your credit card details online, modular arithmetic is used behind the scenes to securely send information to the server. Thus, whilst telling the time might seem like a straightforward activity, this strange mathematical world is in fact a hugely interesting and important area of mathematics. If you want to find out how we can use modular arithmetic to answer some funky number questions, stay tuned because I'll be uploading some answers in the next videos. Thanks for watching, I hope you enjoyed the video. If you want to see more aesthetic, mathsy videos, do check out my channel and subscribe.